And the next one is Katarina Pirak-Siku. Please welcome. And Katarina is an artist based in Jokkmokk, and the title of her presentation is "The Swedish Museum in Sami: To Change Perspective from Object to Mental Independence."
In 2014, I was in Paris for a few weeks, and I went to Louvre a couple of times. And one time when I went from the museum, I had a strange feeling because I had been to the South Pacific area, been looking at the wood carvings, but I couldn't really tell someone why I had a strange feeling. And then I realized it was the same feeling as I had when I was at the archive in Uppsala. During a couple of years, I have been studying the race biology in Sweden. We had a institute for race biology in Sweden in the earliest 100 years ago. It was founded in 1921, I think it was. And when I went to the archive to look at all the pictures, there were no names, just numbers. And it was the same feeling that I had at Louvre. All the wood carvings, they were so nice, but it was no names of the craftsmen. And this picture, I have been working with the race biology in the archives for many years, and I have decided to not to use the photos of the people in this material, and you see that I have used it. But when I was in the archive, I decided to, because I wanted to know how was it to be measured, what did people feel. So I decided to pick photos from young people from my area in Jokkmokk. And this woman, she's proud and she's not young, and you can look at her dress. She's not really from Jokkmokk. And I showed a lot of people this woman because I was thinking someone has to know her. And it was a woman, and she was 90 years old, and she said, she's my aunt. And then she told me the whole story. She had met Anna Michel. She worked at the Institute for Race Biology. She had met her twice. And I have been working with Elsa. I was helping her. She was 90 years old. And I had moved all her stuff from one apartment to another one. And I had asked her about race biology. And she said, I haven't heard about it. And then she saw this picture, and she could tell me the whole story. So I took this picture, and I wanted to give back the family history of Anna. And you see the pattern around the picture? It's a pattern that this family are using on their traditional Sami clothes. And then you see the colored thing up in the top. And it's from the dress that she is wearing on this picture, the same. Because I met Elsa's cousin outside a store in Jokkmokk, and I told her about her Aunt Anna, and she said, but do you know, Katarina, I have the dress, so you can have the piece. So I wanted to give back something to Anna, and I wanted to show that she's not just a number in an album in one archive in Uppsala. She's a person that has a story to tell. This is from the museum in Jokkmokk. It's called Aite, Svenskt Fjäll- och Samemuseum. And 50 years ago, this museum opened, and it was called Jokkmokks Museum. And the collection was based on a collection of this man. His name is Erland Ström. And I have a special relation to this man, because I know that he went to my grandparents, and my grandfather, he was sick. He was drinking too much. And this policeman, he came with a bottle of vodka, and they were drinking, and he wanted to buy things from my grandfather. And when they had this book release, I couldn't go there because I said, maybe I will hit them, because I have been so angry with him. So I have been a lot, I have grown up at this museum because my parents were there a lot. So, and my father, when I was a child, he always showed me things in the museum, and he said, this item is from Lovalokta, and this item, but I was too young to remember. But I have been working as a teacher at the school in Jokkmokk, and they are studying Dudji, Sami handicraft. So we go to this museum, and then I found this small bag. It's not big. And I realized, I really recognized this bag. And I went home, and I saw this one. It's from the same woman who has sewn it. You can see it from the material, the way she's sewing, and so on. So I can say this small bag is from Lovalokta. And when they had the book release, I know that my cousin, she was there, and she said that a man who worked at the museum, he said that we have to be grateful because Erland Ström was a collector. And you know Silvermuseet with the doctor, I don't remember his name now. Oh. And a lot of people are saying you have to be grateful because you have these items at the museum, you can go there and you can look at them and so on. But I don't know if I want to be grateful for Erland Ström. I want to be angry. I want to say, fuck yourself, or something like that. I want to be angry. And this bag, and this one, is sewn by this lady's, or she's my grandmother, but it's her grandmother's mother who has made these small bags. And do you know, my grandmother, she lived in Sweden for her whole life, and she couldn't speak Swedish. So, and I don't know how, I have been wondering, did she travel? Did she go from Jokkmokk to Luleå? And then at the right side, you can see a varmkläde. And it's something that you put under here, and it's called sleppa. And I love to be working with handicraft. It's so nice. And when I'm working as an artist, it's nice to be working with handicraft because it's a lot of rules. You can't do like that and you can't do like that. So I don't have to make any choices. So I love to be working with handicraft sometimes. And now I'm going to sew a slepa for a boy. And his father, he was a friend to my father, but his family, they were Sami, but they weren't Sami because they were farmers and they didn't count as Samis. And they had burned all the costumes and so on. So I have found this picture, and he has a name, you can't see it, but now I have been looking and I can see that he's a relative to the boy who wants to have a slepa. So here I can see what kind of slepa they were wearing. And this picture is taken 1850 of Lotta von Düben. So sometimes I don't know how to really. Sometimes I'm angry, but sometimes I'm really glad to see all these photos and items. Maybe they are good for my own culture. I haven't decided yet how to deal with this thing. But I was going to talk about my Swede museum. I had decided to do it, but when I did the lecture, I don't know. But 12 years ago, I did a Swede museum. And I really, at first, I created my own country. I will show you a map. And I decided our language and capital and money and if we had a king or a president or something like that. And then I went to the library and I looked in the Nordisk familjebok, and I looked at Lapps. What did they write about Lapps? And I was going to do the opposite with the Swedes. And so I did. And in Sami, we are saying laddie. And laddie, it's a word for a non-Sami man. So I decided to call the Swedes laddie, and the female was Rivuku. And I was really going into this to change, and how would I describe a Swede, how the Swedes are describing or has described my culture? And that was a little bit painful. I have never shown pieces from this art work. And I can't find them anymore. This was before I had a digital camera, so I have them on negative. And something changed. And then a couple of years later, I had a great idea because I wanted to take a Swedish man or woman with the nationaldräkt, a traditional costume, and I would put the. I wanted them to hold a cow in the sunset. You know, the Sami image, it's always with our Sami costume, with the traditional costume, with a big hat, with a big bowl. Here and standing with the reindeer. And I wanted to do that. So I was calling to a lot of people in Jokkmokk that I know have the nationalrätt. And something happened in these calls because people, they didn't want to be standing there with their nationalrätt, with a cow in the sunset. But it's my picture that I really want to do. And I have also been thinking, what kind of self-image do I have? So I was really upset with the Sami handicraft because it's so traditional and you have to do like this. And I was working at this school and we were discussing the shoe, and yes, and I was really, I wanted to do something with the Sami handicraft, and so I was working with beads. My grandmother on my mother's side, she was a really great handicrafter with beads, and I wanted to do something that all the craftsmen or the duyar would be so upset with me. And I was also a little bit angry. So I did this kind of underwear and I put them on and something happened here. My anger was, it changed when I was taking this photo. And I think I changed my self-image. You know, from being the woman or with the sunset and reindeer and so on, I became a woman in 2000. I had created my self-image. And I think it was really important for my artist work. This piece is, I'm so happy that I did it, and it was really important for myself. And I think that I went from being a victim to be more, I was taking more responsibility for myself and for my self-image and for my background. And here we have the map. So here is my country. But in this work with the race biology, I have tried to measure myself. I have really gone into this material, and I have done this art piece before, but it was before I knew that the researcher, they went up to people, they went to their home. So I want to show, I have been in a place that I know that this researcher has been, and I wanted to take back the place, and I wanted to put myself in this position. It was really important for me. And here we have all my, I have tried to measure myself because I want to know, was it when you were measured, did it hurt you? Was it painful? And it wasn't, so it has to be something else. And this, I have really tried to avoid these naked pictures, but I couldn't do it. So I have tried to be in the 9 positions myself. I think if I hadn't been, I have 2 young, 1 daughter and 1 son, maybe I would have shown the pictures, but maybe it's so nice not to see their mother naked in an exhibition. So that's why I have been drawing them. Okay, that's all.
Oh yeah, thanks Katarina. Any comments, questions, observations? I'm starting then. You talk about this self-image, and for me, we are sitting in this panel that uses this word remediation, but it's in my head, when you speak, I do understand this kind of the need for healing, perhaps, of this kind of a Swedish colonial wound towards the Sami culture, and epistemology and knowledge. But I wonder, well, my question is, do you think, I'll go direct to the point, through perhaps producing this self-image, this authored self-image, and perhaps doing this healing, are there any wish to have, are there any wish in you to have this knowledge, this production collected in museum somehow? Do you want this new knowledge, this production of yours to be collected back into the museum?
No, I don't think so.
I wonder because the based on the process of going back and retracing, like a little bit of what your abstract says, going from the object to the subject.
Yes.
I just wonder how much of perhaps the colonial perspective would give to, I don't know, not to give back to the museum, but to force them to actually display this new knowledge, your epistemology.
But I think maybe for me it's not so important. I think for me it's more important that I want to tell my own story. I want to be part of the history. I want to write my history. But it's not so important for others. I want to do it for myself and for other Samis, so we feel more equal, that we feel more that we are taking away a little bit of the pain, I think. Because sometimes I think that our history is a little bit painful, and we have to get to know why is it painful. So that's really important for me.
Perhaps, I mean, that makes me refer to the performance as a system of knowledge, perhaps instead of the museum, as knowledge being passed through performance, orally, as perhaps like the Decolonial Museum to be a more performative than, I don't say institution, but a space or virtual one, or through, I don't know, dialogues instead of being withholding, having objects or information withholding in a place, in an institution. We have questions, sorry.
Thank you, Katarina. I wonder whether you think that it should, would it matter who took care of them?
Pardon?
Sami or the majority Swedes or anyone?
Ja, det var ett ord som jag liksom inte uppfattade. Vad sa du?
Do you think that it matters who takes care of these heritage objects?
I think it makes sense that the Samis is taking care of the heritage. But a week ago we were talking about this skelet, and I was discussing with a friend, and she want to have them back, and she want to bury them again. And I said, but hey, wait for a moment. If we are taking them back and we don't know where they belong, is it right to bury them again? Is it right to bury them in Christian ground? Maybe they weren't Christian. So I think that's a question that I think that we have to discuss for a long time. And I'm not sure that we will find the right answer.
Hi, Katarina.
Hi.
I saw your exhibition during Capital of Culture in Umeå. I lived there. I want you to comment on your theme, actually. You worked with your theme at the exhibition.
Yes.
You worked with, if I recall it right now, when sorrow actually gets heritage.
Yes.
Can you say something about that?
I have asked this question for many, many years. Can sorrow be heritage? And I think that the sorrow can go from one generation to another one. But maybe it's something in the history that is repeating. I had another friend, I talked a lot with her before this exhibition, and she said it has been so much that we have just been putting it, we couldn't speak Sami, we couldn't have our own religion. It has been so many layers. And I'm grown up in a very quiet culture, but it has been pushed down just to survive. And I think that we have opened the box, and the sorrow can be whatever. And for me, it's race biology. It could be something else for someone else. But I think it has been really important to open it up, because we have to know also what happened. Because a lot of Sami, they are talking about race biology, this archive, and that's but we have to know what happened. Because we haven't seen it from our point of view, that the researcher came up to the north, they lived with people, and that the researcher came to the school, they didn't ask the parents, and so on. So it's a knowledge that is really important to know, I think.
Thanks, Katarina.
Thank you.